Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
All right, let's continue our discussion of ballistic MOSFETs. So we've seen that it's relatively easy to derive the IV characteristic of a ballistic MOSFET. In fact, it's easier than it is to derive the traditional theory. The results look much different from the traditional theory that we see in textbooks. And what I want to do now is to connect what we've done in the ballistic model to the virtual source model, which we developed under using traditional concepts. And we'll see that we can map the virtual source model onto the ballistic model relatively easily. So by way of reminder, the ballistic model we get simply by applying our Landauer formalism at the top of the barrier. It simplifies to this expression for small drain-to-source voltage in the linear regime, and it simplifies to this expression when F1 is much greater than F2 under on-current conditions. For Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, we can work out that expression and get an expression for the complete IV characteristic of the device. And we can simplify it for the linear regime or for the on-current regime. And the results are quite different, especially for the linear current, than the traditional model. In practice, we may have to do this more carefully with Fermi-Dirac integrals, but that's something that can be done as well. Everything now depends on the location of the Fermi level as well as on the voltages that are applied. Okay, so how would you do this in practice if you wanted to include Fermi-Dirac statistics? So if we want to compute the IV characteristic, we would specify a gate voltage and a drain voltage. Let's say the source is grounded. First thing we would do is to compute the electron charge in the channel. We've seen how to do that last week from MOS electrostatics. And we can account for the gate, and we can account for Dibble. We can do that for sub-threshold or above threshold. Okay. The next thing we need to do is to determine the location of the Fermi energy, because injection velocities and other things in our expressions depend on the location of the Fermi energies. So the way to do that is to remember that the total electron charge is due to the positive velocity electrons, which depend on a Fermi-Dirac integral with the Fermi level of the source, and added to that the negative velocity electrons, which depend on the Fermi level of the drain and a Fermi-Dirac integral of order zero there as well. So that equation can be solved since we've computed the charge from MOS electrostatics. This is a complicated nonlinear equation that we'll have to solve by iteration, but that's easy to do with MATLAB or something like that. And we can determine the location of the Fermi energy. Now, if we're using Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, we can skip this because results are independent of the location of the Fermi energy. Okay, then we can compute the drain current because we know everything. We know the charge. And now, since we know the locations of the Fermi levels, we can compute everything else we need. And we have one point on the IV characteristic. So that's how the procedure would work. Okay. Now, let's switch gears to the virtual source model. I'll just remind you that, again, we wrote it as minus because the electron charge is negative, but charge times width times average velocity. The average velocity was given by this function we called fsat, which smoothly takes us from the velocity under low VDS to the saturated velocity. The saturated velocity now, when we derive this, was the high field saturation velocity. So we know physically that that makes no sense for a ballistic MOSFET. And VD sat was just at the intersection between the linear regime and saturated regime currents. And mu effective is the mobility of the electrons in the inversion layer. That's what MOS people term the effective electron mobility. Okay. And the empirical, we used an empirical relation to connect the sub-threshold charge to the above-threshold charge, and we used an empirical expression to connect the low VDS velocity to the saturated high VDS velocity. And those parts were physically motivated, but that's why the virtual source model is semi-empirical. Okay, so we have this simple expression. If we simplify it for low VDS, we get the familiar expression for the linear region current. It's proportional to the width of the MOSFET divided by the length, mobility times inversion capacitance, and the voltages. The on current proportional to the width, capacitance, the high field saturated velocity. So we get these nice simple expressions that we derived in week one. Okay, now let's compare. If we actually did the calculation of a virtual source model with reasonable parameters, and we did the calculation of the ballistic model, we would get something that looks like this. We would have higher currents under ballistic conditions. We would have a higher slope in the initial region, meaning a lower channel resistance. And we would have a lower saturation voltage, just of a couple of KT or a little bit higher than that if we have Fermi Dirac statistics, but significantly lower than the VDSAT of a virtual source model. So they have roughly the same shape, but the magnitude of the quantities is a little bit different. Okay, now let's talk about connecting the two and see if we can make the connection between these two. Our expression for the linear regime current looks quite a bit different from our expression for the traditional expression. Let's see if we can relate the two. All right, so just a little bit of algebra. The traditional expression has a W over L. So let's divide by L and multiply by L. Okay. Now you'll see why I brought up the ballistic mobility in the last lecture. Because if we do that, we can recognize that this group of terms has the units of centimeters squared per volt second, the units of mobility. We define that to be a ballistic mobility. And then we can write our ballistic current in the linear regime in a form that looks very similar to the traditional form. We simply replace the real mobility by the ballistic mobility. So the traditional theory has a W over L, and it has the actual mobility of electrons in the channel due to scattering in the channel and at the interface between the silicon and silicon dioxide. Now, I'll remind you, later on we'll see, we've seen this once or twice and we'll derive it later on, a very simple expression for the diffusion coefficient is unidirectional thermal velocity times mean free path. The lambda zero just means it's an average mean free path or an energy independent mean free path. Thermal velocity times mean free path divided by 2, centimeters squared per second. So I can relate mobility and diffusion coefficients by an Einstein relation. So if I do that, I can get an expression for the real mobility in terms of the mean free path and unidirectional thermal velocity, and the expression is this. So we frequently derive mobility and we say it's Q tau over M. That's the natural result that comes out of the Drude theory of the MOS, Drude theory of carrier transport. Now, we could also express it in terms of mean free path. Same mobility, just written in terms of mean free path. And when you do that, this is what we have here. Thermal velocity times mean free path divided by 2kT over Q. If you compare that with what we've identified as the ballistic mobility, you can see that in the ballistic mobility, we've just replaced the actual mean free path by the channel length, since there is no scattering in the channel. All right. And we'll talk in the next slide about what that all means. Okay, so very simple. We can relate our ballistic MOSFET model to our traditional MOSFET model simply by replacing the real mobility by the ballistic mobility. Then the expressions look the same. Okay. So what exactly is this ballistic mobility? You know, it's a concept that some people might say makes no sense at all. How can there be a mobility in the ballistic case when there is no scattering? But it's a concept that is actually quite useful to us, and we can attach some physical significance to it. And we can do it this way. So we think about our transistor, and we have a ballistic channel, no scattering at all. Electrons are injected from the source, they fly across the channel without scattering, they come down to the drain, there's a lot of scattering in the drain, that immediately thermalizes them and reestablishes an equilibrium Fermi-Dirac distribution in the drain. They were injected out of an equilibrium Fermi-Dirac distribution of the source because there's a lot of scattering in the source that maintains that thermal equilibrium distribution function. So there's a lot of scattering in the source, a lot of scattering in the drain, and there's no scattering in the channel. So the way we can think about this is that the mean free time, mean free path, is the basically the distance that electrons travel between scattering events. They scatter frequently in the source, then they get injected into the channel, zip across, and they scatter immediately in the drain. So the distance between scattering events is the length of the channel. So for a ballistic MOSFET, we simply replace the physical mean free path with the length of the channel, but the physical interpretation is the same. It's the distance between scattering events. So we can attach some physical significance to this ballistic mobility. It's not just a mathematical convenience that comes by rearranging some terms in the equations. So you can see that as the device gets very, very short, the ballistic mobility gets smaller and smaller. Okay. So it's possible to be confused when you're looking at experimental results and you're looking at very short channel devices. If you deduce the mobility of a very short channel device, you might find it falling. What you might be seeing is that you're reaching the ballistic limit and you're actually extracting the ballistic mobility and not the real mobility. Now, if you ask what happens in the limit, you know, we have in the limit that L approaches zero, the ballistic mobility also approaches zero, and everything goes to a nice limit, and that limit is the ballistic current of the MOSFET. So no problems with W over L going to infinity as we scale MOSFETs to shorter and shorter channel lengths. Okay, so let's take a look. Here's a transistor, you know, built a few years ago, but a reasonably modern transistor with a channel length of 60 nanometers. This particular device had a measured mobility, measured in a long channel device for which mobility was a very clear and easy to interpret parameter. It had a long channel mobility of 250 centimeters squared per volt second. Let's ask what the ballistic mobility is in this device. So we have the ballistic mobility, thermal velocity. Let's keep things simple and just estimate it with a Maxwellian number, 1.2 times 10 to the 7th centimeters per second. Channel length is 60 nanometers, KT over Q is 0.026. We get a ballistic mobility of about 1385 centimeters squared per volt second. That's much bigger than the real mobility. And what does that tell us? That tells us that ballistic effects don't matter because it's the smallest mobility that is going to limit the current. The one that's large would permit higher currents, but the smaller mobility is going to lead to lower currents. So by comparing the ballistic mobility to the actual mobility, we can determine whether we're in a regime where we're expected to be ballistic, expected to be diffusive, or in somewhere in between those two regimes. We'll see how this plays out a little bit more next week as well when we talk more about scattering. Okay, now let's turn to the high drain current regime and look at how we connect the two theories under large drain to source voltage. In this case, it's very, very easy. The expressions look the same. The only difference is that where we had a high field saturation velocity in the traditional theory, we have a thermal injection velocity in the ballistic theory. So the expressions are the same. We just have a different interpretation of the velocity. So the velocity is this thermal equilibrium velocity that the electrons come out of the source at, yeah, not this high field scattering limited velocity. Now, one of the things that's been a little confusing and that's made it hard to understand these devices for a while is that it turns out in silicon, these two velocities are reasonably close. The high field saturated velocity is about 1 times 10 to the 7th centimeters per second. VT for non-degenerate conditions is about 1.2 times 10 to the 7th. as we become degenerate, it increases and can go up to higher values, 1.4, 1.5, possibly even higher. So they're in the same ballpark, and that has made it not, it hasn't been always crystal clear in silicon transistors that something is wrong. These devices are not behaving according to the traditional theory. More recently, people are going in and having to boost the value of this velocity in TCAD simulations, boost it above what is the known high field saturation velocity in order to treat small devices. That's just an indication that the traditional theory is breaking down. Okay, so the high field picture is very simple. What's important is not this region near the drain. Velocity does not saturate there. Even in a realistic device that's not ballistic, there still is not enough scattering there to saturate the velocity. What's important is the velocity that electrons come in at, because the average velocity at the top of the barrier saturates at the thermal equilibrium velocity that carriers are injected at. Okay, so we can wrap up this lecture. We've made this connection between the two theories. The ballistic and the traditional MOSFET models, they give IV characteristics that have similar shapes. And that's because a transistor operates by controlling current flow, by manipulating potential barriers with electrostatics. That's the same in both cases. Now, the ballistic currents are higher because there's less scatter. The transition from the linear to the saturated region is sharper, and the saturated velocity is lower. Okay, so we have these two expressions, the traditional expression, the ballistic expression. The next question to deal with is this all just an academic exercise? Or are transistors today reasonably close to the ballistic limit such that these effects have to be considered and taken account of? Obviously, the answer is the second. Otherwise, we wouldn't be conducting this course. But we'll continue this discussion in the next lecture, which is the last lecture for this week. Thank you.